The very first thing that happened after 9 was, yeah, we got a phone call from Jeffrey Holder, Arthur and I, and said, I loved this show, and I've been reading this book called by Gaston Leroux called Phantom of the Opera, and I think you boys are just the right ones to do it. And I said, I admire you enormously. You know, I love your work. I saw Timbuktu, which he had directed. I said, but absolutely not. I said, it's unthinkable. You know, I came from the age where, you know, the proper subject matter of a musical was Bernard Shaw, whatever. Look, it's a horror movie. You know, the guy gets acid thrown in his face and jumps in the Seine. What are we going to do next? Mothra meets Godzilla, the musical? And he said, well, think about it. There's something there. And I did think about it. He said, just come to one more meeting. So we came to another meeting. And I said, you know, I really have been thinking about this. And I think, once again, I think the problem is, in its present form, something has to change to adapt this. And I think if the character, instead of getting acid thrown in his face or God knows what, if this character is born misshapen in the 19th century, in the age when the Mad Sister was locked in the attic, I said, then he would be living deep beneath in the bowels of the Paris Opera on the lagoon, because nobody could ever see him. But as hideous as he is on the outside, that's how beautiful he would be on the inside. And the beauty would be the beauty of music, the music wafting down through the layers all the way down into the crypts below the opera are as mother's milk to him. And so there's something universal about it. He becomes Quasimodo. He becomes the Elephant Man. And who among us actually hasn't had the thought, despite my outward imperfections, inside, I mean, well, inside, there's kindness and there's love, and it's the love of music. And I thought, that's a story. And Jeffrey said, well, then write that. And then we did. And we gave him a backstory, and we gave him humanity. And it was a joy. It was an absolute joy to write. It was a love letter to Paris, for one thing. There's Melody de Paris, and there's a whole singing contest in the second act about songs about Paris. It's really a French show, and it's quite Rossini-esque at the beginning. And I was really able to write a Rossini-esque kind of overture because I'm in the opera. So it's operatic, it's Broadway, it's funny, and I absolutely loved writing it. And we were going to go to Broadway, and then there was an announcement that Andrew Lloyd Webber was interested in writing a version of The Phantom of the Opera. He hadn't written a note, but that was sufficient, quite rightly, in those days. He was very successful. And if there was going to be a show like that in the West End, that was going to, and were it to be successful, it would come to Broadway, and it would be critic-proof. And so it's not really likely that our show is going to get on. So, you know what? It's show and business, and that's the business part of it. And so it was disappointing, but I thought, well, one day I'll write a French show. I've got the melodies, you know, one has a trunk. And the truth is that I just went on to other projects.